on the track, dude.
Man, I just called Kenny and I said, Kenny, do you want to do Unchained by Van Halen? And he just called me right back and he said, Kenny Aronoff coming back.
Going down the rabbit hole of Unchained. So there's a whole bunch of stuff. First of all, guitar. I was trying all the different kind of Strat type Frankenstein whammy guitars and with the maple neck. And I found that the maple neck made the high F chord. Right, this guy's nuts. Made the high F chord a little spanky. So I tried a couple of rosewood necks, and then the spank went away, but it didn't sound right. And then I thought, okay, so the story, I remember an interview coming out after Fair Warning, and Ed talked about using an ES-335 for the solo, and So This Is Love, which you can hear. And he also used an SG for the slide part in Dirty Movies. In order to get really high where he wanted to go, the horn was getting in his way, so he took a hacksaw and hacked it off, apparently. This is what he says. So, it could have been an SG, it could have been an ES-335, or it could just go back to his love of the Les Paul. So, I tried my Explorer, because it's a hunk of mahogany. You know, it's very close to the old Destroyer that he used on Van Halen 1. But, no. It didn't work. I tried an SG. I didn't cut the horn off. Maybe he used an SG before he cut the horn off. That's a possibility too, but I'm not cutting the horn off to see what it sounds like. Anyways, the Les Paul won. So I used the gold top. It's a 57 custom shop from, I don't have it here actually. It's on a vault on the way to Nashville for a gig next week. Not a gig. It's a pre-recorded thing. There's no audience. Anyways, in case you were concerned for my health. So basically the Les Paul is the gold top 57 custom shop, fat neck, awesome guitar, but it's got an Arcane PX8 in the bridge position, which is an Alnico 8 magnet and mismatched coils and a pretty medium output. So, that worked. It's not the guitar he used, but it sounded the closest to me. That guitar into my Marshall JMP, it's a 1976, it had a barbecue grill. What I found out is that a barbecue grill looks spectacular on the front, but it offers absolutely no support to the box holding this heavy chassis. So I picked it up one time and the bottom kind of fell out. And I'm thinking, fuck you, barbecue grill. But I'm gonna try and make it work. Maybe I can support the structure of the box way better and then put the barbecue grill back on top. But people are like, man, I'm disappointed there's no barbecue grill. There's always a reason. So, so this head, I'll show you the picture of it. This head went into this Boss GE10 Band EQ. The cool thing about this is that I was in Tokyo and somebody gave me a really thick book of Van Halen and photographs taken from the tours in 1978, 79, and Ed had one on all his pedal boards back then. And it doesn't have a foot switch, but it has a foot switch, like a remote switch jack. So if you ever saw an old photo of one of his pedal boards and it's got just an on-off switch, it was going to that. Or actually there's a few, one going probably to the Echoplex or whatever. But I was, as I was looking through the magazine, Shanks called me on the tour and he said, hey, let's go to some guitar stores. So we went to guitar stores and lo and behold, I found that one in the window. Actually, there was two. So I listened to both because I figured, you know, they're old. Stuff changes, dust, this, that. So this one sounded the best out of the two. So that's the one that I got in Tokyo after seeing it in a book. Then this is the flange and you can see it's the original. This is a 1976 or 77. 10 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 10 o'clock-ish, 2 o'clock. A power cable complete with a 60-cycle hum. No light. And the switch, it's an old switch. So it was kind of like, got no light to tell you that it's on. And I couldn't feel the click in my shoe. So that's why I recorded Unchained barefoot. So I could feel the click with my toe. Whatever it takes, right? And then, of course, the breakdown is the ever so popular Phase 90. This is the script, no light, no cable. No, you can't put an adapter, it's battery only. So you have to unplug it when you're not using it so you don't kill the battery. And here's the thing. I have an ISO box outside my studio with a 412 cabinet in it and the mic. And I tried that and I tried the mic in different places. And it's a kind of ISO box that was built around the cabinet, so you can't actually take the cabinet out and put another cabinet in or change the speakers out or anything like that. So I didn't have that at my disposal, so I just backed out of the cabinet and used this thing that Digitech sent me. It's a cab driver. It's a cabinet simulator. It's a dual cabinet simulator. And this did the trick, I think. I'm pretty sure. It doesn't have a load, so you have to put it, I put it through an actual THD hot plate and took the direct out of the hot plate, just so the amp has the load so you don't blow it up. And then that went into this, and then this went straight into Pro Tools, and a little further EQing. I found the cabinet simulator very bassy, so that's why the EQ came in, where I could pull down the frequencies that were really popping and making it really muddy sounding. And then I also cranked up a little 4K, to give it that frequency that's ever so present in that track. And again, you never know, like you have an amazing rig and you play with an amazing band and then they mix it and then when they send it to mastering, they do EQing and stuff like that. So hey, maybe they did something to the guitar. So there's always, you know, you're never ever, ever, ever gonna nail it. It's fun getting close and the rabbit hole continues. Playing. The chugging is so important in that song. There's a violence to it. There's this aggressive, you know, there's something going on with the chugging, obviously. A reckless punch in the face, out of control thing. So I wanted to capture that and it wasn't happening exactly the way I wanted to. So a couple of things that I tried is I raised the pickup so that it was almost against the string. So when I did the chug, there was almost a contact, but not contact, but it still gave it a little bit of that violence. And the other thing was, is you're gonna think this is stupid. If you know me, you know I wear my guitars pretty low, and in this video, I had to wear it a little higher. So I'm working on the tone, I'm working on the chug, I sit in the chair, it sounds great, oh, that sounds awesome, and then I stand up, and the chug goes away. And I'm like, what the hell? So I had to raise the guitar, so it was closer to where it was when I was sitting, so for the palm angle. What? Yeah, I know, it's all crazy stuff. So I think that's everything. I had a lot of fun. Getting Kenny Aronoff on the track was fucking a blast. And Dan's my boy, man. He just sent me in the bass and his background vocal parts and it was like, done. So, you know what would be really fun when the technology comes around where we can actually jam? That would be awesome. But in the meantime, this is the ISO Jam three. But I did want to do the gear breakdown because I think it's fairly important that you guys know when you dig deep into something like this, it's not only, some people think it's tedious, I think it's fun. I was having a blast trying to recreate that tone and trying different guitars. So actually, I'll throw this in too. I called my buddy George Tripp at Way Huge Pedals, who also does a lot of work for MXR, and I'm like, dude, why doesn't the new flange come even close to the old flange? And he said, well, there was the magic chip in there that they took out in the 80s. This guy knows everything, right? I actually need to get it fixed because after I lay down this track with my toe, it doesn't work anymore. Like, I mean, it did go through a phase. Like, I'd be doing a take and it either clicks on or completely disappears. The guitar disappears. So I go, damn, and I'd have to go again. But now it doesn't work at all. So it's going to the shop. So I had a lot of fun. I hope you guys enjoy it. I think guitar players, and I've said this before, I think guitar players are the new nerd. There should be a Revenge of the Nerds 3 movie, and it should be about guitar players and pedals and amps and guitars and how we're nuts we are. There's got to be girls because people won't come if there isn't. But come. No one's going to a movie anyways. Maybe the drive-in. So this is the Gold Top. It's a 57 custom shop Gold Top dark back. Oh, and there's a dog in the corner. And you can see how high the pickup is raised to get that low E string sounding violent. Like sometimes it would even slam in there. And this is the cool light that Mark Van Gool put in. It's that angle, man. That angle is so sick. Okay, so guitar. Oh man, I totally forgot about a goddamn detail, a very important detail. The other reason why I knew it was a non-trem guitar for the rhythm track is because there's only a whammy bar in the solo and the outro. So that meant usually when Ed doesn't play whammy bar on a rhythm track, it's because it doesn't have a whammy bar. So I use the Luxxtone S style, so Strat style. That thing is amazing. It also has an Arcane PX8 in it. I'll show a picture of it because it's also in the vault on the way to Nashville. And that's it, man. What?